Good evening, everyone. Tonight, we will take up one of the pillars of our Catholic faith, which is the Bible. Although our rule of faith is ruled not only by the Bible, but also by tradition and guided by the magisterium, the Bible is the main tool that really builds up our faith. We all believe that it is, in fact, the Word of God, that God himself is the author of the Bible. So I think it's very helpful if we try to understand how the Bible came about, right? So that's what we are going to take up tonight, and then we'll examine the original languages in which it was written and the importance of the translations of the Bible and the history of the formation of the Bible, okay? So we're ready to start. This is going to be the last module of three-part presentation. The first part is the foundation and pillars of the Catholic faith. After this module, we are going to the Catholic practices, understanding Catholic practices, and then we'll go to Catholic morals, the principles of Catholic morals. Okay, so let's go now to the next slide to start with the subject matter for this evening. The Bible is God's written self-revelation. Okay. God is not a cold, distant, super being out there in the space, many, many millions of light years away from us, so he is concealing from us. No, he is not. As you can see in this icon, God reaches out to have a relationship with man. He is not concealing himself, but is constantly revealing himself to us. He is constantly interacting with us. And in the past, he has been interacting with his chosen people. And God did not really dictate anything to them, but they were inspired. And that's what we're going to study tonight. What is this inspiration by God? He inspired his chosen people to put together in writing their understanding of the experiences, an encounter with God, and also understanding the warnings of their prophets. The prophets are the ones who claim to be speaking for God, and consequently the beliefs that they develop. So these people were inspired to write them down, and that is what we call the divine inspiration. And that, in fact, is the origin of the Bible, the inspiration of God himself. Let's go to the next slide. All scripture is inspired by God. That is so stated in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. By inspiration, actually the word used was in Greek, theopneustos. And literally, it means God breathed. Theo means God. Neustos, the breath of God. Ruach, God's breath of life. So it was God who breathed upon the author of the scripture the life of God's word. As you know, there are only instances in the scripture that we know where theopneustos was breathed by God unto creation, for instance, in the book of Genesis. And then again in instituting the sacrament of reconciliation, he breathed upon the apostles the power to forgive sins. Receive the Holy Spirit, whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven them, and whose sins you shall retain, they are retained. So those are very important life that God has breathed upon the apostles and upon his creation. So God really inspired by this breath, these writers, to interpret and understand that the events that's going on in their life by which God was interacting with them. God was, through the Holy Spirit, they are so filled that actually the Holy Spirit is taking an active part in their composition, the ones that they are writing. And that, as a matter of fact, as consequently, God is the real author. Okay? They are so filled by the Holy Spirit that they are raised, these authors are raised to a divine level. So they really understand the workings of God in their lives and the communication of God to his prophets. They understand that and they started writing it until Jesus came. But of course, Jesus is the ultimate interpreter of the law and the prophets. Next slide. So in times past, God spoke to our ancestors, to the prophets, at many times and in various ways. And the writers of the scripture of the Old Testament interpreted what these prophets were saying. Now in the last days, he has spoken to us through his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through him and through whom also he made the universe. And that is Jesus Christ. So the real meaning of divine inspiration was actually captured in the encyclical of Pope Leo XIII. Next slide, please. Meaning of divine inspiration. In the encyclical, God so moved and impelled them to write. He was so present to them, so filled with the Holy Spirit, that they first rightly understood, then willed faithfully to write down, and finally expressed in apt words and with infallible truth the things which he ordered. And this only. So that's the definition in the encyclical issued by Pope Leo XIII. So let's go to the next slide. At this point, we already understand that while God is the author of the scripture, he did not dictate the words of the scripture like dictating to a secretary for transcription. Nothing like that at all. The scripture was written through the inspiration of God. God gave these human authors understanding, wisdom, and impulse to write, but let them use their own talents in their own personal and individual ways, their own style. We will learn more of that, the different ways by which scripture was written by different men through so many hundreds of years, and their own understanding and their limitations are reflected in their writings and their creativity. So it is the word of God indeed, but it is in the words of man. Okay, so the limitations of man sometimes is that they seem to blur the understanding of scripture in their writings, because especially the earlier writers, they always attribute to God everything. To them, God is the first cause of everything. So if they wage war, they attribute it to God. So they picture God as a warrior. Okay, that God was actually the one fighting for them, that God was sending angels, army of angels fighting for them. You find that in some of the books of the Old Testament. Okay? So God did allow them to see that to be written that way. But when Jesus Christ came, he explained everything even more clearly. All right? So the understanding is inclusive of their own limitations of their own culture. So let's get now into the stages of the development of the writing of the Bible. Next slide. Stages of the Bible's development. We start out with the event. Okay. God is revealing his presence, speaking his word, and forming his people, acting in the events of their lives. So that's how God interacted with man. Long before any scripture was written. So there was this epic events about the calling of Abraham, the slavery in Egypt, the call of Moses, settlement in the Promised Land, exile in Babylon, and then when Jesus came, the teaching and deeds of Jesus. These are all events that were happening. His crucifixion, death, and resurrection. And the formation of the church by Jesus Christ himself. All in the context of people influenced by God's self-revelation of himself and the movement, of course, of the Holy Spirit. So the event took place first before any writing of scripture. Because it all, and then the next stage would be the oral tradition. These events, these epic events, these saving events were handed on to oral tradition. They are reached out in the community to which they belong. And of course, the community itself safeguards the accuracy of these traditions being handed down orally. Kind of like our family reunion. Whenever we have family reunion, we almost always want to share what our forefathers have said, our grandparents, and so on and so forth. And whenever one would have a blurry recollection of what really happened in the family, one would correct the other and said, no, that's not what grandpa said. He said another thing. So that's how it was in the oral tradition. The community itself would make sure that what is being handed down is accurate, because the recollection of the community would have to be, there would have to be a consensus on their recollection. And then some of them started writing all these traditions that they have heard in their community. And this is where inspiration come in. God inspired them to put down in writing what has been handed down orally. So they look back on their origins, for instance, the origin of humanity. They try to analyze that, and someone is inspired to write about it. And of course, the inspiration comes from the Holy Spirit, filling him with the Holy Spirit. They started writing about the origins of the chosen people of God. All of this in their community, the eyes of Hebrew faith. Okay, so there are so many different writings written down by different authors of different background in several versions over the next several centuries, until on the next stage, all of these writings were edited again by God's inspiration. They edited most of the Old Testament events, writings were mostly edited during the time of the Babylonian exile. Remember, the chosen people were booted out of their land at Babylon, and then they had all the time to reflect on what has been happening in their life. And this is the time when they were really filled with the Holy Spirit to make an ordered account of the writings that they have been encountering. So they are editing them themselves. Okay, this is how the core of the Old Testament emerged. Now, as regards the New Testament, the evangelists began to organize their collection of writings to form a complete and orderly account. As you know, the people during the time of Jesus, after Jesus ascended into heaven, most of them did not feel the necessity to write the account of their encounter with Jesus Christ, because Most Christians at that time were expecting that Jesus would come back in their lifetime. So they did not see the necessity to write down their experience. But of course, they were wrong. And so Paul was the first one who wrote some of the New Testament writings, like the epistles. He started writing epistles in order to address some problems that are arising in their community. So those are the epistles intended primarily to answer questions being raised in the community and to answer the problems that are arising in that same community. And then, as we all know, the first gospel was written only about 60 years after Christ by Mark, and so on until about 100 AD. Let's go to the next slide. Oh, no, I'm sorry. The canonical tradition. After the editing, all the writings were collected. They were reviewed. They were examined and deliberated upon by the church that Christ founded. And this is in order to officially determine the list of the inspired writings. Now, the authority to canonize or to determine the official list of what are to be considered inspired writings, the authority of the church was universally recognized. Historically, the Catholic Church used her authority to determine which books belong to the Bible, and that authority was universally recognized even by the other Christians who separated from the church, like Martin Luther himself. He, in fact, made a clear statement, and I quote, "We are obliged to yield many things to the papists." He was referring to the Catholics as papists. "And that they possess the word of God, which we receive from them. Otherwise, we would not have known nothing at all about it." So there was a universal recognition of the authority of the church to canonize or to determine which among these writings that were available to them were inspired by the Holy Spirit or not. Okay, so that's canonical tradition. Let's go to the next slide, please. Let's look at the history of the formation of the Old Testament. The first complete collection of books to be accepted by the Israelites are the written word of God, consisting of five books. We know that as the Torah. The first collection was completed about 400 BC. Now, at first, they thought that Moses was really the author of the Torah, but then later on, they determined that while Moses might have written some songs about their exploits in the land of Egypt, not all of them, there were very, very few that Moses really wrote, but actually, the account of the Exodus and other accounts of the Torah were written first by, sometime like around, Moses was living at the time around 1500 to 1200 before Christ. So he started writing some of them, but not all of them, not probably, very, very few of them, But then in the 10th century, during the time of David and Solomon, we have the Yahwist writing his accounts. Of course, again, they were oral tradition that were handed down, and some of the writings that were made by Moses and some other authors, and they started putting them together by the Yahwist. Yahwist because they referred to God as Yahweh. And in the 9th century BC, by the Elohists, because they refer to God, they are referred to as Elohists because they refer to God as Elohim. Okay, but the editing of the Old Testament actually took place during the Babylonian exile by the priest and by the Deuteronomists. The Deuteronomists were the ones who were very particular about the laws of the Jews in the Deuteronomy. So the priestly editors of the Old Testament. So the first collection was complete by 400 before Christ, and the rest of the books of the Old Testament did not have any definitive canon in the early centuries, except to exclude some of the books of the Old Testament in the Council of Jamnia that took place around between 90 to 110 AD. Then in that council, the Hebrew writings that they did not find, the seven so-called Deuteronomical books of the Old Testament were not included. Because, and then much more so, because actually the seven books were excluded just because they could not find the Hebrew edition of these writings. But later on it was found in the discovery in 1947. We'll get to that again. And so they excluded some of these books, and because they also determined that these books were too Christian. So it's a polemic against the Christians. So they, in the Council of Jamnia, they only had, they subtracted seven books, so that the Old Testament in the Council of Jamnia was only like 39 books. Whereas now we have 46 books in the Old Testament, which our non-Catholic brothers and sisters believe erroneously to have been added by the Catholics. But as a matter of fact, we will get to that a little bit later in the course of this talk, that it was actually subtracted by our non-Catholic brothers and sisters in the canonized Old Testament. The formation of the New Testament, formation of the New Testament. The earliest list of the New Testament books that historians have discovered is called what we call the Moratorian Canon, dated about 180 AD. And in that list, we didn't have all 27 books of the New Testament. What we had then at first were the Acts of the Apostles, the 13 letters attributed to Paul, the letter of Jude, the first and second letters of John, Revelation, Wisdom, and the Apocalypse of Peter. But in the third century, disputes continued over some books, and by the end of the fourth century, there was a general agreement throughout the church on the 27 books of the New Testament. Okay? So let's go now to the canonization of the Bible. Next slide. How was the Bible put together? That is the canonization. The official list of inspired writings were determined by the church in the different councils. It started out in the Council of Rome, 382 AD, under Pope Damasus. And then in the Council of Hippo and the Council of Carthage, which affirmed the finding in the Council of Rome of the inspired writings. And this was under the direction of St. Augustine himself in the Council of Carthage in 397 AD. So by the fourth century, between 382 AD to 397 AD, we already have the canon of 46 books of the Old Testament and 27 books of the New Testament. They determined that it was necessary to also canonize the Old Testament, because sometimes it is being questioned, why do we need the Old Testament? Everything is now new under Jesus Christ. Well, St. Augustine explained this very well. The New Testament lies hidden in the Old Testament. You can have a better appreciation of the New Testament if you understand the Old Testament. And the Old becomes clear in the New Testament. That's a quotation from St. Augustine. So what are the criteria for the canon of New Testament scriptures? Let's go to the next slide. We have the apostolic authority. It should be within the tradition of the thoughts of the apostles. So remember this, all public revelations ceased with the last apostle to die. So after the apostles, no public revelation was ever added, because when Jesus Christ came, he embodied and shared with us the fullness of truth. Nothing can be added. We can later on understand it more fully, but no private revelation can ever change any of the revelation that has already been handed down to us by the apostles. So the next criteria for the canon of the scripture is conformity with apostolic tradition. It should faithfully reflect the teachings of Jesus given to the apostles. It should be apostolic. If there is any teaching that does not reflect that which was given by Jesus to his apostles, that would not pass the scrutiny of canonizers of scriptures. And another criteria is the continuous acceptance and usage by the church at large, not just a particular community, but practically all churches, the universality of the acceptance of these traditions. So those were the criteria used by the church in determining which among the writings that they collected together and they examined should be part of the Bible that we have now. So they classified all these writings to rule out those that are deemed not divinely inspired. Let's go to the next slide. These are the classifications that they determined. Classes of sacred writings. The reason why they classified that is to rule out those that are deemed not divinely inspired. Some of them may have been inspired, but not necessary to guide the people of God in their faith. So even if some of them are inspired, they are not included in the canonized scripture because they do not need to be there in order to pursue the central theme of the entire scripture. You know, the central theme of the entire scripture is man's redemption. That all of the books of the scripture are pursuing that singular theme of the redemption of man. So the classifications are as follows. We have the proto-canonical books. They didn't have any problem with them, with those books, because they were universally accepted. There were not any questions about the fact that these have always been used in their community, and therefore they are determined to be inspired and useful for the faith. And then the second classification are the disputed writings, the so-called seven added books of the Old Testament. These are the books that do not appear in non-Catholic Bibles. Okay. The Book of Wisdom, Sirach, Judith, Baruch, Tobit, 1st and 2nd Maccabees, and some parts of Daniel and Esther. So that was under dispute. You call that under second consideration. That's why it's called deuterocanonical, belonging to the second canon. In other words, the dispute about these writings will have to be resolved first before they could be included in the canonized scripture. In the New Testament, there were some questions about the books of James, Jude, 2 Peter, 2nd and 3rd letters of John, Hebrews, and Revelation of the New Testament, especially the book of James, which, as we have already learned, Martin Luther labeled the book of James as an epistle of straw. Okay, and then we have the apocryphal writings which are not considered inspired, such as the Gospel of Peter, the Gospel of Thomas, and the letters of Barnabas and Clement, and so on and so forth. Our non-Catholic brothers and sisters classify these seven books of the Old Testament as apocryphal, but that is not correct because they were actually canonized even as early as when they found that those so-called missing versions of the Old Testament books in Hebrew could not be found. All right? So let's go to the next slide, the history of the deuterocanonical books. First, the Old Testament, as I just mentioned, the seven books. They were first rejected by the Jewish rabbis in the Council of Jamnia. And then, because they could not find the original in Hebrew, the original manuscripts in Hebrew, and they also found these two Christians, and so they wanted to reject Christ, and so they thought that it's good to exclude them so it would not have any foreshadowing of the coming of Jesus. This is known as the Palestinian Hebrew canon. In other words, those writings of the Old Testament that they found all in the Hebrew language, okay? They could not find the other seven in the manuscript in the Hebrew language. However, research into the Dead Sea Scrolls in Qumran in 1947 brought about the discovery of the ancient Hebrew copies of these disputed books. And then the Protestant canon adopted the Palestinian and Hebrew canon because they find it consistent with their rejection of the doctrine of purgatory, which is supported by one of those rejected books, the Second Maccabees. In Second Maccabees chapter 2, verse 46, there is a passage there where the Maccabees, led by Judah, were praying for the dead. That is the basis for the teaching in purgatory, which we will take up in another lesson that we will be having in the future. So our non-Catholic brothers and sisters always insist that you don't need to pray for the dead because if they are right with God, they are already in heaven. So no amount of prayer, we need their prayer, but not us praying for them. They are already in heaven. What for? And if they are in hell, no amount of prayer for them would ever extract them out of hell. So that was the reasoning. But of course, we will learn that in Second Maccabees, it has always been the practice, during the time of the Old Testament, very close to the time of Jesus, that the practice of praying for the dead was already in place. All right? So let's go now to the history of the New Testament, the deuterocanonical books, the disputed books of the New Testament. Next slide. All right. The disputed books, again, as I said, were the epistles of James, which Martin Luther says an epistle of straw because it is diametrically opposed to the doctrine that he was promoting, that we are saved by faith alone. And the book of James is so clear in stating that we are saved not by faith alone. So he didn't really like this epistle. He called it an epistle of straw. So he also tried to exclude from the canonized scripture some portions of Jude, 2 Peter, 2 and 3 letters of John, Hebrews, and even Revelation. But eventually, he did not succeed in having these books excluded. And so they all agreed on the canonization of what we have now, the 27 books of the New Testament. So that's the history of the disputed books of the New Testament, the deuterocanonical books of the New Testament. All right, let's look now at the languages and translations of the Bible. it's important for us to understand that, next slide, that the Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew language. Surprisingly, some people think that the original language of the Bible was the King James English version of the Bible. Of course, that's very far, farthest from the truth. The original language was written in Hebrew. That's why, you know, understanding the Old Testament is not that easy. We needed some theologians who are expert in the Semitic language of Hebrew to help us understand the import of the Old Testament. And then the New Testament was originally written in the Greek language. That was the universal language at that time. Except the Gospel of Matthew, some scholars believe that it was written in the language of Jesus himself, Aramaic language. But that's very similar to the Greek language too, right? So let's go now to the different translations. So that was originally written in Hebrew, and then the Old Testament, and then the New Testament was originally written in Greek. Next slide. Let's look at the translations. Translations of the Bible. All 46 books of the Old Testament was translated into Greek. Take note, not just 39 books. All of them were translated in Greek by about 72 translators during 285 to 246 before Christ, during the reign of King Ptolemy II. This is known as the Alexandrian Greek canon. Remember, the canon of in the Council of Jenya is called Palestinian Hebrew canon. Only the Hebrew manuscripts of the Old Testament were canonized in the Council of Jenya. But now when they were translated into Greek, they included the translation of the seven books, and it is called the Alexandrian Greek canon, Septuagint, 72. There were appointed six translators from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. So 12 times 6, 72 translators, and that is translated into Septuagint, 72. The New Testament was originally written in Greek and later on officially translated into Latin. All right, so the first translation, official translation in Latin, is called the Vulgate. Pope Damasus commissioned St. Jerome to make this translation into Latin. Both the Old Testament, which has already been translated into Greek at that time, and the New Testament, all from Greek to Latin. And you know what? It took him 15 years to do the translation in Latin. Although there were already translations in Latin being made called the Old Itala, but they were not very accurate. And so officially, the translation was universally accepted by the 9th century and was the first book printed when printing was invented in 1450. The Council of Trent officially adopted the Vulgate. I'm sure you've heard about the Vulgate, the Latin translation of the Greek Old and New Testament. Right. Let's go to the history of translations of the Bible into English. Next slide. English Catholic translation of the Bible. The first translated book of the Bible into English was the Book of Psalms, 700 AD, but in a Saxon language. The English language was not yet developed. It was the Saxon language. It originated from the Saxon language. And then in 1582, several years after, the new translation in English was completed at Reims, France. That's the translation of the New Testament into English. And the Old Testament was translated into English by 1610 at Douai, France. So you called it Douai, Reims, translation, right? And these were translated by the English people that fled the Reformation, okay? By 1943, Pope Pius XII ordered that the translation of the Bible should be made again, this time from the original language. So it's not from Hebrew to Greek to Latin and so on, but rather make the English translation from the original language of Hebrew of the Old Testament and Greek of the New Testament. So it's more accurate that way, because, you know, so many translations tend to lose the meaning of the scripture. You know, they say lost in translation. So Pope Pius XII was very careful about that. He made sure that the translation is as close as possible to the original language in which it was written. So the result, we have in 1972, the New American Bible. This is a translation from the original language. And then in 1986, they revised the New Testament portion translation of the NIV. And then in 1989, they made this so-called RSV or Revised Standard Version of our non-Catholic brothers and sisters' translation of the scripture into more contemporary English, yes, the NSRB. So that's the Catholic English translations. Now, let's look at the Protestant English translation of the Bible. All right. Next slide. Protestant English translations of the Bible. Wycliffe translated it into Old English around 13 AD. As you know, we have taken this up when we were taking up the history of the church, that Wycliffe was actually the forerunner of Protestant Reformation before Martin Luther. He tried to translate the scripture into Old English. You know what? The Old English is a development from Saxon language, but still, if you read the Old English now, nothing is understandable at all. It doesn't even sound like English. So nobody reads with the Wycliffe translation anymore. Then another reformer, William Tyndale, translated it. By reformer, I mean those who translated scripture on their own without the authority of the church. You know, as you know, before the Protestant Reformation, there was only the Catholic Church. And the Protestant Reformation brought about the splintering of Christianity, mainly between Protestants and Catholics. So they made this translation from the original Greek. That is good. William Tyndale had a very accurate translation of it. Then during the time of King James, around 1611, King James Version came out. This is a very popular version among our non-Catholic brothers and sisters. The King James Version of the Bible was published sometime in 1611, but there were so many errors found from this. As a matter of fact, they found about 30,000 errors. Most of them are misprint, errors in printing, like, for instance, the verse, let the children first be filled, the King James Version would read, let the children first be killed. So that was obviously a typo and an error in printing. So there have been a lot of revision of the King James Version, the original King James Version, from 1963 to 1965, in collaboration with the Protestant scholars and theologians. The Catholic version of the RSV, okay? Because the RSV is the Revised Standard Version that improved on the King James Version that was in 1952. And then in collaboration with them, the Catholic came out with the NSRV, the new Revised Standard Version, acceptable to both Protestants and Catholics, except, of course, the exclusion of the seven books of the Old Testament. Because you see, you have all these books. So it doesn't mean that when you have a Bible, it doesn't matter what kind of version you have, because it's very important that you have the correct translation of the Bible, because once you have the erroneous translation of the Bible, even Revelation itself can be lost. That is the importance of having an accurate translation of the Bible. So let's go to the next slide. It is important that we try to decide properly which Bible to use when you do your Bible study or even your Bible reading. You just don't get hold of any translations, because some of these translations would incorporate the doctrines that were being promoted. For instance, the translation by Martin Luther, we took this up and we have this already, in Romans chapter 3, verse 28, Martin Luther added the word alone in his translation of that verse in Germany. So as to support the doctrine of salvation by faith alone. And then the Jehovah's Witness in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 1, which reads, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." I have not checked this out, but you try to check it out yourself. They said that the translation of the Jehovah's Witness is, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God." So that completely, dilutes or loses the very core of Christianity. We don't become a God ourselves. The Word itself is God. The Word is God himself. That is what John stated in John chapter 1, verse 1. So let's look at the two principal considerations in the Bible that we should be using. We should look at the accuracy of translation and the meaning of English, of it in English, because we speak in English, we understand the English. I don't think any of us is familiar with the other languages of the Bible or translations of the Bible. So it must be clear and readable, because if it is not clear, if you cannot understand it, then what's the use? If you don't understand the book that you are reading, you can be misled and you can completely misread it. So there are two methods of translation: the formal equivalence method, or word for word translation. So word for word, as close as possible. This is a very good method to use in determining which Bible to use, because it's more accurate. And we have what we call dynamic equivalence method. The dynamic equivalence method actually is clearer in English, more understandable. But as I mentioned a while ago, the problem with some of these translations is the incorporation of their own personal understanding, not the official understanding of the scriptural passages. As you know, we are being guided by the church in our understanding of the scripture. So we have the parameters of understanding the scripture so that we will not go beyond the official doctrines of the church. I know that some of us may think that doctrine is not important, because religion is not important. It is our relationship with God. We totally agree that our relationship with God is primordial. However, our religion determines the way we relate and we understand God. So there cannot be a dichotomy between doctrines and our understanding of scripture. So we must take this into consideration in deciding which Bible to use. Anyway, in the church, in the Catholic Church, we are guided by the official review of the bishops and the authority of the church. So if you look at your Bible, at the very first page, normally you will find the imprimatur, or at the very least, nihil obstat. Nihil obstat means there's nothing objectionable is found. Imprimatur is that there is an official approval of the translation of that particular book that you're reading. So we have the guidance of the church in regard to that matter. Okay, finally, let's go to the next slide. We have the authenticity of the scriptures, because as you know, there is no original writing of this scripture available. All of them have either been destroyed or they have perished through wear and tear because they were written in very brittle and easily perishing material, like the papyrus. So what we have, everything that we have, are only the manuscripts. So the question is, how do we know that this manuscript is a faithful reproduction of the original writing? So we have the scholars of the scriptures call this science textual criticism, which means the closer the manuscript to the date of the event recorded, and the more manuscripts are made, the more reliable the manuscript would be, all right? So for instance, the Dialogue of Plato was, there are only two manuscripts available, and it's far removed from the date of the original writing of the Dialogue of Plato, but they were universally accepted. Caesar's Gallic War was determined to have been written between 58 to 50 years before Christ, but the earliest available copy or manuscript of it was dated only 900 years after Christ. Yet, it's the Caesar's Gallic War is universally accepted. Now, what about the Bible? Oh, we have 5,000 manuscripts in Greek found, 10,000 manuscripts in Latin, 9,300 manuscripts of the original language, and they were written very close to the happening of the event. So that's what you call textual criticism. So we can be sure that the Bible that we have, although they were based only on manuscripts or copies of the original as they were no longer available, are faithful reproduction of the original writings. Okay? So I hope we have covered clearly how the Bible came about, how we should understand the languages, the fact that the languages of the scriptures were not written in our language, and therefore we are very reliant on the scholars of Semitic languages. So we are being guided by the church for that. And this is very important because, you know, God's revelation, the truth that Jesus Christ handed down to us in full, can be lost in translation. And that would be disastrous and very misleading to understanding. Okay? Thank you so much. And we will now proceed, break up in groups for discussion of the following questions. The discussion questions.